So is it like a compactification?
Well, you can think of it that way. In Euclidean theory, it's a compacted relation, but I mean the way we derived this, right, is just that you wanted to calculate trace of e to the minus beta h, right? And while translating that into the path integral language, we found that you have to put a periodic boundary condition on the Euclidean tensor, right? Then you can try to interpret this as a compactification of the time circle, but that's not a physical compactification, right? Because it's really Euclidean formalism, right? The physical time is not being constant.
So, this temperature can be thought as a compactified
dimension. Yeah, period of the imaginary time. But this is only in the specific context that when you are actually want to calculate trace e to the minus beta h, right, you can think of this as if you are doing an Euclidean calculation with the Euclidean time direction being compacted. Other questions? So let me write down the Hamiltonian that we arrived at yesterday. So the Hamiltonian was given by integral dd x here the dynamical variables are a, I, a. These are like the analog of the coordinate variables. And pi I a are the conjugate momentum variables. So you can think of this as the kinetic term and this as the potential term for the theory. But then we also saw that besides this Hamiltonian, you have to impose an additional constraint on the theory, namely that you have to define the physical subspace of physical states by imposing that di pi I a x t is equal to 0. And then you also saw that this is equivalent to saying that physical states are invariant under time independent gauge transformation. And you can check that the gauge that you have fixed, okay, A0 equal to 0, that gauge condition is not disturbed by a gauge transformation which is time independent, right? Because if you take an epsilon which is time independent, then A0 doesn't change, okay? So A0 equal to 0 remains A0 equal to 0. And that is also reflected in the fact that this Hamiltonian that we have written down, or the corresponding Lagrangian, okay, you can also take this Hamiltonian and convert this to a Lagrangian by thinking of by the standard procedure. That is invariant under time-independent gauge transformation. Is this clear? Because you see, when you go to the Lagrangian, this becomes del naught ai whole square, right? With a minus sign, del naught ai doesn't change under time independent gauge transformation, right? Because time independent gauge transformation will shift AI by epsilon, okay? But when you take the time derivative, it vanishes. This one you can easily check that it doesn't change on a time independent gauge transformation, because AI goes to del I epsilon, okay, and Fi is any man's invariant. Okay, or for non-abelian theories, it transforms covariantly under time independent gauge transformation, so it's also invariant. So we'll call P as a projection operator into states that are invariant. Is this clear? So P acting on a state will give you back that state if the state is gauge invariant, otherwise it will give you 0. If the state is not gauge invariant, P acting on the state is equal to 0, right? That's the definition of P. Okay, and last time we also wrote down an expression for P in terms of this integration over theta, okay, but we will come back to that later. So what you want to calculate is a partition function to this trace of P e to the minus beta h. Where the effect of P is to ensure that the trace is taken over only those states which are invariant on time independent gauge transformation. Now we want to write a path integral version of this. So what we do first is that we break this up into many pieces. N pieces, as in n times epsilon is eta. And in between, this is not necessary, but we can always do it. I insert a P. The reason that it's not necessary is because since P commutes with H, okay, H is invariant on a time independent gauge transformation. So since P commutes with H, we could have always taken P to this side. Okay, so P square is 1, but I can just insert factors of P in between. And now the idea is that you want to interpret this as a path integral. So with this P is inside. Is this point clear? Now to do this, we have to go back to the original derivation of path integral. So let me remind you the derivation of the path integral description of this given in quantum mechanics. Okay, then we will try to generalize it, okay, to quantum field theory, and then we will see the effect of inserting P. Okay, so first let's forget about P. Okay, let's just review what we need for quantum mechanics, okay, to get the path integral description. So let's go back to PM. So there we had Z, which was trace e to the minus beta h, which you could write as integral dq q, and then beta h you write rho and many copies of epsilon h. And then we rewrote this as integral dq, then product I equal to 1 to n dpi, and dpi product I 2 to n dqi, and then you have q equal to minus epsilon h n n n u n. Okay, this step was not strictly necessary, but I am doing it anyway. Let's do this. So, and then like this, the last one is q2 e to the minus epsilon h u1 u1. Okay, just inserted a complete set of states in between. Then he evaluated this matrix element by saying that this is e to the power minus epsilon times pn square by 2m plus b of qn, okay, up to corrections which can be ignored in the epsilon goes to 0 limit. And then these were given by e to the I pn qn, right? That's why we not product with the momentum I n set and a position against. So declaring that q1 is q and qn plus 1 is also q, so that this is what was responsible for putting periodic boundary condition on q. Okay, only in this case that you can write it in a neat form.
So this
is
the square is
always
zero, right?
This square is identity.
This square is p.
Rotation. Rotation
operator.
It's p.
Oh yes, p.
So this we have to write this e to the power minus epsilon is even number of times.
No,
p square is p, not identity.
Okay.
Yeah, p square is p, right?
Any power is p.
Yeah, exactly. Any power is p. Okay. Once you are projected onto the singlet state, right? Then if you apply p again, it will remain the same.
Yes.
So wouldn't it be then useful just to put p in the definition of h, like h tilde is p of h, and then this formula becomes identical to your.
Yeah, you can do that.
It
but I mean, you don't want to put it in the exponent, we want to put it here. Okay, we will see why.
Okay.
Okay, you can put you can add log p.
Yeah.
It doesn't look very nice. So
okay.
We just put p as it is. Okay, so after doing this, the final result that we had gotten was integral product I equal to 1 to n dpi by 2 pi product I equal to 1 to n dqi. Okay, so basically the q, the dq we are interpreting as dq1. Then you had exponential minus epsilon vqi. And then minus sigma I equal to 1 to n pi square by 2m. And then you had plus I sigma I equal to 1 to n qi plus 1. Okay, these factor came partly from this inner product, right? E to the I p I q I terms came from here, from these, and the e to the I q I plus 1 p I, right, that came when you took out the minus v minus p square by 2m, and then you are left with the inner product between q n and p n minus 1, right? Q I and p I minus 1, that gave rise to that
term. Epsilon in front of p I square by
2m. Yes, thank you. Now, if you recall, in while trying to derive the path integral expression in quantum mechanics, okay, at this stage we had just performed an integration over pi. The Gaussian integral, so you completed the square and integrated. Okay, but let's postpone it for a while. Okay, so at this stage, what we will try to do is to write a continuum version. Okay, without doing the integration over pi. Okay. So in that case, so this is in the n goes to infinity, epsilon goes to 0, with n epsilon equal to beta in this limit, we can write this as integral d of p tau d of q tau and then exponential minus these objects become integral 0 to tau d tau of v of q tau plus d tau squared by 2m plus I v of tau d q tau. It's clear, this just goes up to your integral, this goes up to the integration. Okay. And this one, I took a put an epsilon outside and made it qi plus 1 minus qi by epsilon. Okay. So this becomes p times dq d tau. Okay, that's what I've written.
The integration range is beta.
Pardon?
The integration range.
Yeah, range from beta. Thank you.
And the last one, should be with a minus sign?
Last time should be with a minus sign, yes. Is this okay? So at this stage, if we want, we could have complete the square, right, and get back the same result that we had gotten earlier, right? Because we just write this as p tau minus d m dq d tau whole square, right, and then whatever is left, half m dq d tau square, you have to add back, and then the p tau integral we just do by Gaussian integration up to constant, we get back the expression that we had got. But we will not do that, we will keep it as it is for now. So what we are going to do now is to see how this expression would generalize for a field theory. In particular, the case that we have is Gates theory. How will it generalize? That's not very hard to figure out, because all that will happen is that instead of p, you will get integration over the pi i's, path integral over the pi i's, instead of q, you will get a path integral over the AIs. And here, instead of V, you will get the 1 quarter Fij, Fij. Right? And instead of P tau square over 2m, we will get that to half pi I, pi I. Okay, and then this one as usual. So let's write that down.
Is not also to include the projection of water?
We are going to, so right now we are doing it without the projection of water. Right? After we write the expression without the projection of water, then we will study what will happen if you are also trying to insert a projection operator. This gets to the point we are, first doing it without the projection operator. So trace for today's theory, back to Gates' theory. So if we just had trace of e to the minus beta h without projection operator, it would have gone into integral d pi I x t times exponential minus integral 0 to beta d tau integral d dx and then we have 1/4 f i j plus half pi i a, these are all functions of x and tau, okay, I am not writing them explicitly, okay, I have written it once here, and then minus i, pi i a del tau of a i a. Is this clear? So now you want to insert p. Okay. I'll do this for abelian gauge theories. Okay, I'll leave it as an exercise to do it for non-abelian gauge theories. I have not actually seen it done explicitly anywhere, but it should be doable more or less by gauge invariance. Okay, but I'll now describe how to do this for abelian gauge theories. So take E1 gauge theory. So in this case, there is no confusion about projection operator. Okay, you don't have to worry about hard measure and so on. The projection operator in this case is directly integral d theta a of x exponential I pi I theta a of x di pi of x. This is what we.
What is the a index here?
A index. Well, I can put an a index if
you
and this is daylight. But what you have to do is to insert this projection operator between every interval. Okay, so this is one projection operator. But when you write this as e to the minus epsilon is etc., then at every tau, which you have discretized, every discrete value of tau, you have to insert this projection operator. Is that clear? So the final projection operator that will be inserted is integral d theta x tau exponential I, sorry, this was a an integral dqx dx, but now it's I integral d tau ddx theta x del I minus x. Okay, let me put this is, okay, let's imagine that it's not u1 but just abelian. Okay, so basically you have the sum over A, but the f abc is at 0. Okay. So product of u1s basically. Okay, so different A's refer to different u1s. Okay, it really makes no difference again.
Here also theta 1 phi is independent.
Yes, x and tau. So is this clear? This is a single projection operator, but because you are inserting this projection operator between every time step, we have this, right? So this basically came from, so this is nothing but product over tau of many projection operators, right? This integral d tau is nothing but in the outside the exponent, it was just product of tau, right? This is independent integration over theta x tau for each time interval. This guy, there is no tau derivative anywhere, right? As you can see, so different taus are independent integral. Right? I could have written this as product over tau outside and drop the tau everywhere from inside, okay, including the integral d tau. So if you want to insert this projection operator at every time step, okay, in the path integral, what you have to do is that inside this integrand, okay, we have to insert this factor. Is this clear? So insert it here. So we get integral d pi I a d I a d theta a and then exponential minus integral 0 to beta d tau d cube d dx. So, 1/4 Fij Fij and half pi Ia pi Ia and then plus plus I times pi Ia of, okay, I'll change something over here. No, it's okay, I think. Okay, yeah. So this integral I can do integration by parts. Okay, I can put the del I on theta I by picking up a minus sign here. So I can write this as I pi I A times del I theta A minus del tau. Yeah. Okay, there is already the minus pi I A delta A I A here. all I am doing here is that I am also adding this real life data item from coefficient of pi.
How will we argue that, because this time t is compactified, right?
This time?
The time is compactified.
Tau is compactified, yeah, so it's on a
circle,
yes.
Okay, sir. So the boundary term, I was wondering, due to this integration by parts.
You see, these are special integrals, right? This integration by parts that we are doing
Is
a special integral.
Yes.
As long as the fields fall off at infinity,
this,
this will go away.
Okay, for all.
Is this?
Yeah,
are there any other questions? Okay, so now what you are going to do is to finally carry out the pi I integration by completing the square, because it's still in the form of half pi I a plus this. So I can complete the square and then remove the integral. Okay, so let's.
So one thing.
Yes.
This theta parameter that you Gauss transform.
Yes.
Actually, we thought that it is not time dependent.
Yes, so it was not time dependent, that's why this was a projection of part, right? So now what we are saying is that this is, okay, this time dependence is fake, because now we are just saying that we are inserting this projection of part in between defined intervals. Okay? I am just calling the theta that appears here as theta of x and tau, that's just a labeling.
So,
based
to say that the tau dependence is implicit, not x. Implicit means in the sense it comes with x.
No, it doesn't come with x. No, no. It's not. See, for each x, we have this projection operator, right? If there is only one projection operator, this is all we'll insert. Okay? If there are two projection operators, we insert a d theta I and a d phi a. Okay? Now, what is happening is that these different thetas and phis, right? One I am calling theta of tau 1, the other one I am calling theta of tau 2. Right? That's the labeling. And because the number of such things that we need is equal to the number of intervals that the tau has, okay, I can always choose to call them theta of tau, x tau, right? And that's natural, because what it is going to multiply here is pi I of x and tau. So because this object, okay, when you insert a projection operator, say, in the ith step, right, it will be sandwiched between qi and pi, right? So it's natural to call this pi I of the corresponding tau. Okay? But as a projection of order, it doesn't really matter what you call it. Right? As I said, this is tau is just 11. Is this point clear? Okay? That this operator has no tau dependence, right? But when you put it inside a matrix element, okay, which say acts on a state pi I of tau n. Because we had this pi, right? We had at some point this qi pi kind of object. Right? When you insert this projection operator here, right, this pi I is an abstract pi I, right? It's an operator. But when that pi I acts on this, right, it will become this particular eigenvalue, right? Pi, which in the partial integral notation we have called pi I of x and tau. Okay? Whether you call it theta of x and tau is completely up to you. Right? You may choose to call it something else. Except that for each tau here, there should be a theta. Right? So you might as well call it theta of x and tau. Right? That's all we have done here. Is this point clear? Okay, so I'm going to erase this now, because this has already gone in there. So now complete the square, okay. So you get integral d pi a d pi a d pi a is okay. So I just completed the square, and the square of this term I have to add back to that. So at this stage, you can carry out the pi a integral by completing the square. Because it's already square, so you can just shift pi i a by this variable and then integrate it out. Is that okay?
In thermal field theory, also I understand here also this shifting this pi IA means is that will affect the ground vacuum state or means?
No, it's a Gaussian integral, it's suppressed, right? There's a minus sign here,
right?
So, as a mathematical statement, it doesn't really do anything. Like if you take integral from minus infinity to infinity,
right,
it will be power minus alpha x squared. Versus say minus infinity infinity e to the power minus alpha x plus I a whole square.
Right.
These are exactly identical.
Yeah, because the range is minus infinity.
Because the range is minus infinity. Right? And then in the Euclidean portion there's a Gaussian subtraction. There's a minus sign, right?
Yeah.
So the, even though RID continuous and etc. you don't have to do. These are this is the same. Okay, you can explicitly check. Is this okay?
I will worry about the integration range minus infinity to infinity.
Yes. Okay. So the point, I don't want to make any shift. Okay. Take this object. Okay. Take the right hand side. Okay. Suppose A is small. You can expand it out.
Right.
Right. And you check that every term in the expansion is zero. So I'm not, I mean, I can prove it by shifting, right? But if you don't believe that, you can shift, right? You can, you have this choice that you don't shift, you do this integral, right? Assume A is small, okay, expand out in power series in A, and you can check that every power in A, okay, is actually zero. Okay, so this is really an identity. I mean, if you put it on a computer, the computer also gives them their value is the same. Okay, where a computer of course will not know about shifting, right? You just do a standard Gaussian integral. Is this, yeah? And the reason is that, the reason that this shift is allowed is because the, I mean, at plus and minus infinity, right? Where you may say that, okay, maybe there is some contribution. See, you are integrating like this, minus infinity to infinity, right? This integral, okay, is like, I mean, if you shift, right, you are integrating along some other contour. Okay. Now, what is the difference between these two? There are the poles in between, right? So, the difference between these two is somewhere at infinity, these vertical lines, right? But those contributions from those vertical lines, you can easily check that they are going to zero because of the c to the minus alpha x squared. Okay, doesn't matter how large A is. Okay, for any large but finite A, right, as you go sufficiently far out, you can check that the contribution from those vertical lines are just zero. Is this okay? So now, as I said, I will rewrite this up to a constant of proportionality. So throughout, I'm just ignoring constants of proportionality because that will fix later. We get integral dIA exponential say this, okay? Okay, so now I'm going to rename variable. Okay? So rename theta A as A tau. Okay, just a change of name. So we get integral G A I A tau A. Well, I should have said that I mean throughout this, even though I have worked only with gauge fields, okay, if there are other matter fields, okay, they will just go around. Okay, there will not be that much change in the effect of the matter fields.
I mean,
they will
be additive to this.
Well, they will be additive except the fact that the constraint is now not just di pi I equal to 0, but di pi I plus whatever the current comes that from the matter sector, the J0, that should be equal to 0. Okay? J0 is something made of the matter fields. Okay? So, the result after you do this, right? Let's see. So, in the projection operator, right, we had this del I theta A times di pi ia, right? You will also have a term which contains a coupling between theta a and j0. Is it okay? Or theta a and j tau, right? Because you have done this Euclidean continuation. Okay, so you have an extra term, other from theta a times j tau. The otherwise, this goes through exactly. Okay, so exponential. Let me write 1/4 where mu nu now run from tau and 1/2. Okay, FA ij is already there. FA tau i is exactly this tau. Okay, FA tau i will have delta o I minus del I a tau. So okay. So either is FA tau i and FA i tau, right? That's what makes this 1/4 into half. Okay, here I have written 1/4, but there is an FA i tau and FA tau i, which are the same. So that makes the 1/4 into a half, so that's exactly what this is. So after doing all this, we arrive at a very simple result, namely that we could have taken the original action, okay, and then just made a weak rotation, okay, Euclidean continuation, and done the path integral. That would have been equally good. Okay. But here you wouldn't have a justification, okay, because we knew for sure that the original action gives states which are not physical, right? Yeah, but what we see is that here is that if we actually sum over physical states, define the partition function appropriately as trace over physical states, at the end of this, okay, the prescription that we arrive at is that you take the original action, make a Euclidean continuation, okay, the same way you go from SM to AC, right? Namely I SM, okay, under the t goes to minus I tau replacement, goes to S minus AC, okay, follow the same procedure, okay, you would have gotten the right answer. Is this point clear or not?
What's the point?
Inserting
this P in the trace of T.
Yes.
Only after adding that P, we.
Exactly. So if you didn't include the P, suppose you had done this gauge fixing at in the A0 equal to 0 gauge, right? You got certain states. Okay. If we had just taken the trace over all those states, then you wouldn't have gotten the right answer. Okay, you have to insert the P. So it's only the trace over the physical states, okay, that gives you back the original gauge invariant answer. but this time in after
Euclidean
rotation.
So,
yes.
Then what goes wrong for the t equal to 0 thing? Means in
for
t equal to 0 Young-Mills theory?
Yes. Nothing goes wrong. The t equal to 0 of this is the usual Young-Mills path integral. Right?
Yeah.
At in infinite volume.
We don't need to introduce
PRST
cost.
We don't need?
Yeah.
We don't need to introduce.
No, we need. Because now we have to do this integral, no?
Oh.
Because it's gauge invariant now.
We just reached the initial point.
Exactly. So after doing all this, we reach the initial point. From here, now we have to evaluate this path integral.
At the starting point, we fix some gauging.
Yes.
Using some temporal.
Yes. But then you have to also insert a projection operator. In the process of inserting the projection operator, we got back an effective gauge invariance. It's basically the fact that this projection, see this gauge invariance that you have restored back acts non-trivially on theta, right?
Okay.
So it basically is a redundancy in the way of writing the projection operator. That's all it this is. Okay, you wrote integral d theta I times something. Okay. But that itself has a gauge invariance. Okay, that's what we are getting back. Yeah.
So, these unstable states are coming because of this redundancy of the gauge
invariance? Yeah, because in the gauge theory, we know that it doesn't have a standard canonical quantization, right? Not all fields that appear in the Lagrangian are physical, right? So the A0, for example, is not a physical field, right? So you see its equation of motion gives a constraint. So you gauge fix, you impose the constraints on the states, and then you set up the path integral. Okay, so now see at that stage we have a canonical formalism. We know what you have to calculate, trace e to the minus beta h, right? Whether you go to path integral or not is up to you. If you are just doing QED, you can just do it directly. Okay, trace e to the minus beta h. But now suppose you want to give a path integral description. Okay, then the path integral description is this one. Okay, because to define a path integral give a path integral description, it's not just enough to calculate trace e to the minus beta h, you also have to insert a projection operator. In the process of inserting the projection operator, this A0A, okay, of course this is not the analytic continuation of A0A, but this came as the constant, the integral, integration variable that imposes the projection.
Sir, also in this, case,
yeah. Well, no, it should come because now this is the starting point, right? That's what I said. That after all doing all this, you didn't have a path integral description of the partition function to begin with, right? After you now this is, see, you cannot evaluate this path integral without gauge fixing, right? Because this object, this action has the original non-Abelian gauge invariance, Abelian gauge invariance in this case, is generalized to non-Abelian gauge theorem. We just replace it by non-Abelian. And you can also see here that if we had other matter fields, right, where theta A would have given, there would be a product of theta A with J0, right, or theta A with J tau, right, that will generate back the A tau J tau term. Okay, so you can check that this fact that you get back the original action also holds even if there are matter fields present. Okay, the theta times j, right, that goes over to a times j, and that's exactly the term in the action.
Also, there's a tail tau appearing on theta is
over. No?
Tail tau appearing.
Exactly, there's no delta appearing on theta, right? That's what shows that there's tau dependence is somehow fake, right? That it's really a product of different theta that you are integrating over. Okay? In fact, theta n plus 1 never really enters. If you just go through this, right, theta n plus 1 never really enters. So, you at the level of this discretized path integral, right, you don't have to declare how theta is periodic or antiperiodic. Okay. But now, when you do further manipulation, right, it will be more convenient to think of theta as a periodic variable. Okay, because if, for example, theta is not a periodic variable, then part of the action may become non-periodic. Which is okay, I mean, on the original path integral, right? It was perfectly okay because you had a set of theta n, so you never have to talk about theta n plus 1, right? So So the theta n plus 1 is theta 1 or minus theta 1 doesn't matter, because theta n plus 1 never appeared in the discretized form. But when you try to write this continuum form, it's best to write it in a form where everything is periodic. In particular, the integrand is periodic, even though you never had to go to the n plus 1 step. So for this reason, we'll take this eta or theta to be a periodic. Because all the other AIs are of course periodic. Is that clear?
So you said introducing this projection was redundant then, the gauge symmetry was restored. So how was it redundant?
No, it was not redundant. We inserted this projection operator, okay, and in the process of inserting that projection operator, the integrand developed a new gauge invariance. That's what happened. Right? Because now you can see how, for example, this has a gauge invariance, right? You know how the various fields transform. Okay? And you will see that the generic gauge transformation, eta will transform non-trivially. Okay? So basically, once you have introduced a projection operator, a new symmetry appears which acts simultaneously on the thetas and the ais. Because, see, after all, what was the purpose of A0? Right? Integral over A0 gave the projection operator. And the fact that di, ei, ei equal to 0, right? That came from the A0 equation of motion. So it's perhaps not so surprising that when you try to now impose that constraint in terms of this integral, that integration variable will have some resemblance with the original A0.
Yeah, because at the initial point we have to put the constant in the integration by delta of di a0.
Yes.
Yeah, di pi a, right?
Di pi a,
so
yes.
That is basically we are making up to normalization integration of di a0 into the power a0 into this constant.
Yes, that's right, exactly.
It means ultimately this thing.
Yeah. Is this point okay?
So for non-abelian to reach this point, we only have to be careful about the measure factor.
Yes.
Otherwise
it takes a straightforward. Yeah. Okay, because this fact that the integral d theta a e to the power I integral theta a di e I a, that this is the projection operator, right?
Oh.
This is not quite true for non-abelian, right? Because the generators don't cover. So the measure factor is a little tricky, right? I have not seen it worked out in detail from scratch anywhere. Okay, but I mean one generally takes this as a starting point. Take the non-abelian axiom, make the Euclidean continuation, and that you take as a starting point of your defining partition function, finite. These DIEIAs, for example, right? I mean, this is like a generator, right? A non-abelian group. You are trying to work up a non-abelian singlet into singlet of non-abelian group, right? That the generators don't commute. Okay, so the DIEIA with DIEIB, right? If you actually calculate the commutator, then you will find a non-zero answer because DI has the A in, sitting inside. Questions? Okay. So let me then go back to non-abelian theory. and our starting point then will be the z is given by integral dA mu. Now I'll write it as dA mu A. But it's understood that this is what Euclidean A, and then exponential minus AC. But AC is 1/4. Okay, because it's Euclidean, I'm not writing up or down. Okay, because the metric is just delta mu. So now, starting with this, we follow the standard route of what we would do to quantize a non-Hamiltonian gauge theory. Okay, you have to do carry out this path integral. Now, you know that this path integral is ill-defined because of the flat directions. Okay, so if you have the configuration space, okay, which basically is the space of all the MUAs, then in this configuration space there will be gauge orbits. These are gauge orbits. So gauge orbits basically mean that all the points on this configuration space are related to each other by some gauge transformation. And the rule is that you pick one point from each gauge orbit. And try to rewrite this integral as an integral around that slice. So this is what is called a gauge slice. Okay, so this, as I said, is just standard, whatever we did in PFT2, I am now just going to follow. So we'll choose gauge slice as of the form, let me write H A of x tau minus some A of x tau equal to 0. Okay. So these are fixed functions. These are constructed from MUA and other fields. Okay, I could have set the VH to 0, but I have kept it for a definite purpose as we did in the earlier course. Okay, but these are just fixed functions. It could be sine x, cosine x, whatever. Completely up to us. So then we are going to impose the gauge condition by taking the product of delta functions of these variables.
And B have to be also periodic under tau into tau plus beta?
Yes, B has to be periodic under tau goes to tau plus 2 pi. Because otherwise, since this is a periodic function, okay, automatically, it doesn't make sense to equate it to this unless this is also periodic. Okay. So then using this, I can write z as integral. So this is integration over the group. Integration over gauge group. With hard measure.
functions should not be gauging gradient.
Pardon?
Those functions should not be gauging gradient.
Yeah, these functions shouldn't be gauging gradient, exactly. Okay, otherwise it will not fix the gauge. Then integral E mu A product on x and tau delta of AJ x tau minus PA of x tau then e to the power minus AC and then determinant of M. Okay, well, let me remind you what the matrix M is. So M has index A, B and X, X tau, Y tau prime. This is given by the functional derivative delta H A theta, delta H A X tau theta, delta theta B Y tau prime at theta equal to 0, where H A X tau of theta, H A X tau of theta is the gauge transform of H A by theta. Theta is a set of parameters. So this is the way we have defined our functional derivative, and this was an identity, right? If you remember our analysis of non-Abelian gauge theory, we could start from the original path integral and manipulated it to rewrite this form. Right? This delta function takes away some of the integration, but those integrations are hidden in this integration over the gauge. Over the gauge theory. Now, in the case of while you are doing just a quantum field theory at zero temperature, right? Regular quantum field theory, we didn't worry about this because this will be will be taking ratios anyway, right? We have to divide by Z, right? Zero is not the important thing, but interest in calculating correlation functions, you have to divide by this, so you didn't have to worry about this. Okay. Now Z itself is of interest, okay? So you may have to worry about this, but the point is that this object is an overall constant. It may depend on temperature, but it is an overall constant that doesn't depend on any other parameter of the theory. Okay, if you use the appropriate normalized group volume, right, which is independent of the coupling constant, then this integration is just a constant which could at most be a function of temperature, but not on any of the parameters of the theory. Okay. So we'll not worry about those constants for now. Okay. We'll fix it at the end by comparing with the free theory result. See, as long as you know that this constant only depends on temperature and other parameters of the theory, okay, we can fix it at the end by knowing the result for free field theory. Okay. Take the coupling constant to zero and fix that constant. Okay, so we'll ignore this for now. We'll only worry about the, this part of the problem. Now, the next two steps are also identical to what we did. The first is determinant M, we want to write as the integration over the ghosts. So, determinant M, we will write as integral dc bar A dc. Times exponential minus integral d tau dx d tau prime dy in ab And now one important point, that the host fields of course are Grassmann valued, but they have to be taken to be periodic. The reason that they have to be periodic is because these, the functions of which naturally couple to M, right? See, what is this index B? You see the index B came from the Gauge transformation parameter. Okay? Gauge transformation parameters are periodic, right? Because they transform A. A is periodic, so they better be periodic. Okay? Gauge transformation parameters are periodic. Gauge fixing function are also periodic. Okay, so because the C bar, okay, is in one-to-one corresponding to the gauge fixing function, and the C is in one-to-one corresponding to the gauge transformation parameter, okay, both of which are periodic functions, okay, we have to impose periodic boundary conditions on C and C bar. Okay, even though they are Grassmann valued. Why?
H is constructed from M, so I can think of periodic.
Yes. Well, if H is periodic, then it doesn't make sense to impose this constraint, right? Unless B is periodic.
Yes.
Right? For this reason, you have to choose B to be periodic. But right now, I'm just using the fact that H is periodic, right? At that, in that equation, B doesn't enter. Is this point clear? So what we saw earlier, that if we want to represent a trace over fermionic states as a Grassmann integral, then we have to represent that Grassmann, we have to impose an antiperiodic boundary condition on those Grassmann variables. Now we are not trying to represent any trace, right? We have got a determinant, and that determinant you want to rewrite as a integration over Grassmann variables. And that requires that these Grassmann variables C and C bar have periodic boundaries. Not antiperiodic boundary condition.
C and C bar are two different Grassmann variables.
Two different independent Grassmann variables. You can think of C and C bar as complex conjugates, but it's not necessary. Because the rules for Grassmann integration doesn't matter whether C bar is a complex conjugate of C or not.
Yeah. If that is complex conjugate, can it happen that under, even in the antiperiodic boundary conditions, C suppose goes to minus C and C bar goes to minus C bar, then this term can also remain fixed, right?
Yes, that is true. But the point is here, individually, right? I mean, when you are trying to calculate a determinant of an operator, right? The operator acts on some function and produces some other function. Okay, so it's not a question of whether this action is periodic under the tau transition, right? It's like when you calculate a determinant, you have to say which kind of functions it's acting on, right? And that the kind of function it's acting on are periodic functions, right? That's the determinant you want to calculate. Okay. And so for that reason, you have to, when you try to represent it as a path integral, right, you have to take C to be a periodic function, right? But you are right that if you are only interested in this whole thing being periodic, right, then you could have declared that both C and C bar are antiperiodic, right? This will still be periodic. Is this clear? Okay, so that's one point. The second point is to convert this delta function into some exponential. Okay, and that also we had given the standard trick. Which is to observe that if you use integral b a exponential minus 1 over 2 xi integral d tau, is some constant. Okay. So what you do is that you take this z and multiply by that constant, because constants you are not worried about anyway. You multiply by that constant, that doesn't depend on any of the parameters of the theory. So you multiply z by that constant. Okay, write that constant at this integral and now bring it inside. Okay. Once you have brought it inside, okay, you will have to do the b integral first, okay, using the delta function. Okay. That effectively replaces this ba by a change using this delta function. So this then gives z as delta. I'll write on the final expression. So this gives you z as integral d mu a d c bar a d c a exponential minus ac. This is just a Euclidean gauge invariant action minus a cos 2. And write what it is, minus s gauge fixing. S post is S gauge fixing. Basically, what happens is that once you take it inside, then B gets replaced by H. So you get 1 over 2 xi d tau d dx H A H. Okay, that's the S gauge fixing. So 1 over 2 xi integral d tau dx.
The S ghost for zero temperature theory, there is no two variables, right? X and Y, only single variable.
Well, to begin with, there are two variables, right? If you choose the gauge fixing condition as local functions of A, then basically this M has a delta, which makes it one variable, which is true here also. Right? We'll choose a Lorentz gauge, for example, and then it will become this one variable, one integration variable. But in the most general form, right? If you take H A of x and t to be some dependent on A everywhere in space and time,
non-local
gauge fixing function, then it will have two variables. Is this okay? Are there questions? Okay, so this is basically more or less what we had done for normal gauge theory, right? Okay, the only new thing that we have to take into account as the periodicity conditions, right? And for example, we saw by doing this analysis that the ghosts have to satisfy periodic boundary conditions, okay, even though they are grasp of that. Okay, if they are matter formulas, they of course satisfy anti-periodic boundary conditions as usual. So let me, in the next 10 minutes, quickly do the Lorentz sketch, because that's what we will be using next time. Lorentz gauge. Well, I mean, let me say covariant gauge. Okay, Lorentz gauge is a specific choice of zeta, you know, psi. So HA, let's take M A B X Y. Okay, so here X stands for X and tau, and Y stands for Y and tau prime. So this will be delta delta theta B of Y of the gauge transform of this. So minus d mu. Okay, let me put del mu. Del mu, del mu. Okay. So you know what mu of theta is? Mu of theta is del mu theta A plus G F A B C mu B theta C. Let me put A B here. So that is B C, right? So this gives you minus writing things in one step, but I think it should be clear. So what am I doing here? So minus del mu, I have for mu theta, I have put this. Okay. So minus box of theta A. Right? Box is del mu del mu. Box is del mu del mu. So minus box of theta A, okay, this is of course at x. Okay. So when you take the y derivative with respect to theta v of y, you will get first of all delta a b, and you will also get a delta, this is delta d plus 1, d plus 1 dimensional delta function of x minus 1. Is okay? And then you get additional piece, right, which is here. Let me not write it, okay, but let's just focus on this term. But it will also have a delta x minus y. Okay, which will remove the worry that there are two integrals, right? Really, there is really one integral if you have the local function. So then the ghost action is ghost once you substitute this, here it becomes integral 0 to beta, beta of, integral 0 to beta, beta of prime, integral d dx, integral d dy, and then c bar a, x minus y, c bar a x, then box x of delta b plus 1 x minus y and c bar b y.
So delta c.
Sorry, c. And then the minus sign. This step. So now I can just move this box either here or here. The box x is the same as box y acting on delta x minus y. And I can get c bar a box c, c a. Okay, because delta m x can be equal. So let me write the ghost action once more. S ghost becomes integral 0 to beta d tau integral d dx c bar a minus box c. Okay? Minus.
Yeah, so because it is box.
Yeah, minus is. Because this, yeah, but integration of parts doesn't matter, right? We already integrated twice. The gauge fixing function here is 1 over 2 xi integral d tau dt of x del mu mu epsilon.
Equals to B.
Pardon?
3 equals to B.
Oh, 3 equals to B, yes.
Okay.
I mean, eventually, the calculations we will be doing, you don't have to worry about D versus 3 because we don't have any divergence. Okay, so we will just set D equal to 3.
Okay, limit
is
also
0 to
B.
Pardon?
Limit.
Tau, limit. So, tau. Tau, yes, 0 to B. So when you calculate AC plus SGF, this is equal to an action. Then basically for xi equal to 1, okay, so for xi equal to 1, which is a gauge you will be working with, this basically becomes integral, half integral 0 to beta d tau a mu minus box MUA plus interaction box. So basically there is an F mu nu term, right? So if you just pick up the kinetic part of F mu nu, right? Del mu nu minus del nu mu whole square. We have two kinds of terms. One is mu box mu. Other one is mu del mu del nu nu. Okay, that mu del nu nu term exactly cancels the gauge fixing term if you choose xi equal to 1. Okay, that's this is the final gauge. Okay. So the reason that you have chosen these kinds of gauge is that Feynman rules are now simple. When you try to derive Feynman rules, this is just 1 over box, 1 over k square, right? For the ghosts also, it is 1 over k square. Okay. And then of course you have interaction particles. Right? There are lots of interaction particles exactly as you had in the zero temperature case. Right? So now the strategy is the following. For the zero temperature, sorry, not for zero temperature, in the weak coupling limit, we already know the gauge theory partition function. Suppose you extend the coupling to zero. How do you know the gauge theory partition function?
Bosonic harmonic oscillator specifically.
Yeah, it's bosonic harmonic oscillator, but there is even a simpler answer because in the G goes to zero limit, it just becomes a set of abelian gauge fields. Right? Because there is no interaction, the FABC term has no effect, right? So, and we know already the free energy of a gas of photons.
Yeah.
That we know from just our statistical mechanics analysis, right? So at zero temperature, you already know this. So we'll basically fix the normalization at zero temperature by this comparison. What is non-trivial is the ratio of the partition function for interacting theory to the partition function for the free theory. Sorry, I didn't mean zero temperature, I meant free theory. Okay, finite temperature partition function at free theory. So the ratio of the partition function at for non-zero coupling to the free partition function, that is given by the standard expansion of Feynman diagrams, right? The vacuum Feynman diagrams. So those are the ones we will calculate using Feynman rules. And then to get the actual partition function, we have to add to that, or you have to sort of multiply it by the partition function of the zero temperature, right? Which you already know what it is, right? And in fact, we will also see that we can reproduce it from this analysis. Okay? Although that you can say will be somewhat accidental, because you have been throwing all the overall normalization factors anyway, right? Okay, but we will see that you have not done too much damage, even though you have thrown out some overall normalization factor. We will get correctly the partition function at zero coupling also from this formalism. Okay? But what is the reason that quantum field theory is necessary, or this path integral description is necessary, is not for calculating the partition function at zero coupling. Because that is just a gas of photons, right? You just multiply it by the number of gauge fields that you have. Okay? But the ratio of the partition function at non-zero coupling to the partition function at zero coupling. Okay, that is what is given by the Feynman rules.
So, sir,
low
temperature,
yes.
Where these things will be?
Okay, if you don't have matter, then the temperature doesn't really matter, because there is no other scale, right? So if you don't have matter, okay, let me maybe put it this way, that imagine that you are doing a weak coupling expansion, okay, and you don't have matter. Then the temperature dependence on the partition function is fixed by T to the 4, as T to the 4, right? So there is nothing to, worry about high or low temperature. Right? Temperature dependence is fixed. You just have to calculate the overall coefficient. Once you introduce matter, then things are more complicated. Okay? And once you take it, okay, that is perhaps not completely true, because you have to also worry about the dimensional transportation, right? In QCD, for example, we know that even though there is no mass scale to begin with, right, there is an intrinsic mass scale. Right? Because QCD is an interacting theory, right? There is an intrinsic mass scale of QCD. So in principle, things could depend on T over lambda. Okay? But in the weak coupling expansion, it will just be T to the 4.
So at high energy,
yes.
The QCD becomes free.
Free, exactly.
So that is like a non-interesting.
Yeah. So at high temperature, right, the QCD partition function, okay, will approach that of a non-interacting gas of gluons.
What's at a low temperature,
will this part of it kill? So at low temperature, part of it will not be valid, right? Because basically what will happen at low temperature in QCD, and what is expected to happen, is that the basically once you go below the blue ball mass scale, right? Because the gluons are not really correct excitations of the theory anyway, right? So the blue balls have a certain mass. Okay? Once you go below that mass scale, then the partition function will fall off as e to the minus a over t. As you saw, for for a gas of massive scalars, right? But that, for that you have to use some non-parametric physics. Okay, because blue ball mass, for example, you can calculate using part of motion theory, right? But that's what one would expect. But what we will be doing is parametric calculation, okay, in gas theory, okay, assuming that the coupling is small, and then we will see what we will get. Okay, in particular, we will calculate the correction to the mass of the photon or the gluon. Right? Because we have seen that there is thermal contribution to the mass, right? And that is necessary for controlling the infrared divergence, right? I mean, and that same story happens here, right? For the scalars, if you remember, when the scalars ran in the loop, right? The massless scalar ran in the loop. Okay? You are getting more and more infrared divergence, right? And the way we cured it is by resolving, right? We have to first calculate the temperature dependent mass. And think of the propagator not as 1 over k square, but 1 over k square plus that temperature dependent mass square. Okay. The same thing we have to do for the gluons. Right? Because gluons are also massless, they are propagating in the loop. So they will cause infrared divergence, okay, unless we resum and include the thermal mass of the gluon. Okay, so next time we will see how to calculate the thermal mass of the gluon. Okay, again using standard particle. Questions?